everyone. Welcome to Upbuilding the Self. I am so lucky to have all three of my partners here at Upbuild with me. This is Vipin speaking, and I have Hari Prasad, Rasanath, and Michael with me today. Hey, guys.
Hi.
Hey.
It's rare to be together like this.
We haven't done a podcast with all four of us in many months. And I really enjoy these conversations with all of us. And it's usually because we have a topic that all of us have something to say about. It's relevant to all of us. We all have personal experience with, and it's something that we all want to participate in. So that's the topic that we have today, which is on the subject of cutting corners. Cutting corners. So it's a topic that, as Hari Prasad was sharing right before we recorded, is something that we have observed all over the place in our society, in the people in our lives, as well as in each of us, in ourselves. And we often are cutting corners without even thinking about what we're doing. And so we wanted to actually really get into understanding what are the sort of the mindsets behind cutting corners, and what are some of the consequences, especially the unintended ones that we are unaware of. So that is our topic. And I wanted to start with I'd love to hear from you guys. What is important? Why is this so important for us to be discussing, for all four of us to be discussing?
Well, I can start by saying how there are several examples of cutting corners that I have engaged in my entire life, and the effects, the silent effects of it, both on myself and on other people, I have only realized it over time. I can give you several examples. One example of cutting corners that just comes to mind, very fresh, is how when you read a book and you're making a presentation and you are quoting from the book without giving credit to the person who quoted it or wrote it. And I have been guilty of doing that several times. It's a way of cutting corners, because you could easily justify and say, well, we had very limited time and I wanted to make sure that the person or the people that I was doing the presentation for were very impacted by the message. So it didn't matter who got the credit. But ultimately, I do get the credit. It just happens in a very silent way. And what's the line between that and plagiarism, right? It's something to think about. That's one way I have engaged in cutting corners a lot. And it's taken some coaching and some calling out and it happens very innocently. It can be said, well, I'm not really trying to take credit. I just didn't have the time. But what is really happening is something right. That we have to ask.
I really appreciate this example that you started us off with. And I think it would be helpful for us to define what we mean by cutting corners. Because even when I hear that example, when I think of cutting corners, I think of shaving off, saving some time, doing something more efficiently. And the example you gave, sure, maybe there's a saving of time by not mentioning the author who spoke that.
But that's not the real reason.
That doesn't feel like a huge efficiency gain. So I would for me, it doesn't even strike me as a corner cutting example, but almost as a, you know, yeah, there's something else going on there. But I think it would be helpful for us to define what is cutting a corner?
I think it's anything which is not going the full distance for what is required. And
anything that is not going the full distance for what is required.
Yeah, and this is where it gets really tricky, because the question is, well, what is required? How do you really know? And are there some corner cutting things where, like, you can get away with like having bringing the requirement down in order to, you know, for a greater good, so I can do more, so I can focus on things that matter more, or like, is, you know, is the requirement really that high? I mean, it just brings up a lot of questions. But how I think of cutting corners is that is because there's a negative connotation to it. There's the reason we're talking about this is because there's something problematic about it. And why is it problematic? Because there's something more that's required of us that we're not following through on.
Okay. So yeah, it can feel very subjective though. So what is required? Like that feels like it could be a moving target. What is the full distance? Could be a moving target. And then is that look different for different individuals? What's the full, is the full distance exactly the same for you as it is for me, as it is
right.
for myself?
So now you see why this is such a tricky subject and why it's that we live in this amorphous world where like, it's almost to the point where anything goes. I mean, that sounds extreme. But there are a lot of examples, especially the heroes that we worship, where it's kind of like, yeah, but, and you brought up the example of Lance Armstrong, who we talk about in our workshops. I mean, everybody was doing it. I was just normal. Like, what was the big deal about me doping? I was just doing what you do. That's what you have to do.
I was just doing it better.
I was just doing it better. Exactly. And I got caught. Right. Like there's so much of that. Of course, Elizabeth Holmes is a great example now, but there's so many of these people that are coming to light, and there are so many people that have not yet come to light, and so many who will never come to light. And there's so many smaller ways and people that are not as influential, but it's this mentality. It's this cultural current that allows us to revel in the gray. Revel in the fact that, well, I don't know what's really required. And this is so subjective and we can kind of dance in this.
Well, so two things. One, when you first said that we're living in this amorphous world where kind of anything goes, that really struck a chord with me. I feel like I've lived in that world my whole life. Like, yeah, there are no rules. And so I just have to determine what makes sense here. And that's how I move forward. But so that resonates a lot with me. When you share the examples of Lance Armstrong or Elizabeth Holmes, that feels quite extreme all of a sudden. You know,
yes.
That's like, okay, yes, but in Elizabeth Holmes' case, there's a legality issue and it feels like lines up, that crosses over into a different realm, and Lance Armstrong as well. So are you saying that it starts as innocently?
Yes.
And that's where it can go. But there are many people for whom it's not even going to get close to those realms.
That's right. Yeah. And the issue is that still those people at the top who get caught, the people that do the extreme things because of a culture, also shape the culture further. And now we may not get to that extreme, but it is affecting our mindset. And why do we have no rules? Why did that strike a chord with you? It's because our society and the people that are really in the leadership or influential or worshipable positions, if you will, they have not given us examples and we've not received training in our education for how to draw these lines. We don't have the lines. So we may not get to that extreme, but we are getting further and further away from ourselves because we're swimming in this gray.
Mm. I was thinking it's freedom to not have the lines and to be able to make up your own rules. And you're saying that actually it's been the lack of having those models and that instruction is obviously has a very dark side to it as well.
Yeah, I mean, look at government. That's the thing which shapes, at least it's supposed to shape society the most. And government is all about cutting corners and all about like, I mean, politics, you say the word and already it like, it's like there's an eerie feeling about being political because it's not about actually drawing the lines and shaping a society of character that we talk about it in name, but you just like scratch a little bit beneath the surface and you see that's not what's going on. And yeah, we like that freedom that we're afforded, but there is a heavy cost to it. And we'll talk more about that, but we get further and further away from ourselves, our potential, our core.
Okay, I want to come back. I want to bring Michael. I want to ask you a question. You have something you want to say?
Yeah, please. Actually, I want to share one thing. And there's a little bit of irony in where this came from, because it came from the orientation that we had when I was a first year analyst working for an investment bank. And one of the things they told us when thinking about cutting corners and ethics in general was, think about this thing called the Wall Street Journal test. And the Wall Street Journal test was a thought exercise that one would need to go through, thinking about, should I do something or should I not do something? And the question that one needed to ask themselves was, would I want this and everything that happened to end up on the front page of the Wall Street Journal? Would I be okay with it ending up on the front page of the Wall Street Journal? And again, the irony on where this came from is not lost on me. But I actually found that it was for somebody who has struggled with my own moral compass in various ways throughout my life, I actually found that it was a pretty good way of checking myself into what was actually something that was cutting corners and would have negative consequences, versus what was something that was just in service of efficiency and being better.
Okay, there's so much that we have to come back to here. I think Hari, you shared a definition around cutting corners that I think we'll keep building on and sort of refining over the course of this conversation. I also, you said the word character, and I think we want to come back to that, because that seems at the core of what is the cost of what we're talking about. And so let's make sure we put a pin in that one. And then Michael, yeah, so you had this, I don't know, what do you want to call it? A thought experiment to help you draw that line. And what do you use today? So that was, you know, 15 years ago when you were starting out as an analyst, and now many years later, what do you use to help you determine what that line is? Like Hari Prasad is saying, we haven't been given good models and we don't have a lot of good instruction around this. So how do you determine what's okay? When is it okay to cut a corner and when is it not?
Well, I still struggle with it. And I think I do have good models in my life now. And I think that's been the big shift from 15 years ago when I first received this instruction to where I am now. And again, there's still like personal struggles that I have to go through with this stuff. But we actually, even all of us have good models in some way. And I think when we're really paying attention to it, those models speak to us from inside. And so for me, there'll actually be voices of other people in my life that I'll hear kind of on my shoulder or in my head that will speak to me when I'm doing something wrong, letting me know about that. Whether I answer that call and honor that is a different story. And that's
like the angel and the devil on your shoulders.
Yeah. It's not so different than that.
The good dog and the bad dog. Which one are you going to feed? Okay.
One thing that occurs to me in the example that you gave from your banking orientation, Michael, is it's a very external approach. It's not really looking at what is intrinsically the cost. It's looking at, well, how will this reflect on me?
You know, it's a shame-based approach.
If people were to discover that I did this, and then that leads to other issues besides just that, like the internal moral compass is not really being built, but it leads to other issues because it's like, well, what would people be okay with me getting away with? And that's a lot of what our society is about. It's like, what is normal and okay to get away with rather than intrinsically best for myself and everybody else?
Yeah, there's no, it's all a relative criteria.
Yeah.
Like, there is no real absolute.
Yeah. And like, would this cause a scandal? I mean, when you talk about front page of Wall Street Journal, that's what comes to my mind.
Well, that's where they were coming from when they gave us that instruction, was trying to prevent scandals.
Don't cause a scandal.
Yeah. I mean, that was it. And in the absence of absolute internal stuff, that was a bridge to getting there.
But do you see how that in and of itself is cutting a corner? That's cutting a corner about cutting corners. Because instead of actually trying to build the character, it's like, let's just save our butts.
That makes a lot of sense, that you're using it's a shortcut to developing character. And Rasnath, you're saying, so is there any absolute? You asked the question, what is the absolute? There's no internal kind of absolute line around right and wrong. And that question is, does that exist?
Well, I think if we were to truly sincerely ask the question, so for example, when we are, and this goes back to what you were saying, Michael, when you talk about what is the ethical line around doing the job that we do, what is the basis of even relative ethics, right? Like when others feel that it is wrong, then that means it must be wrong. But then you're still basing it on somebody else's. You can only have a relative when there's something absolute. You cannot have a relative without having something that's absolute. Right? Those are two sides of the same coin. So to me, we all know. You can look at this in the eyes of a child, right? When a child does something, you tell the child, well, you know, I don't want you to do this. And then the child does it. And you look into the eyes of the child, you know, the child knows it's done something wrong. It's not the sense of right and wrong is just so inherent. In fact, we can't even do wrong without actually justifying that it's right. Like everybody who does something that is wrong has an inherent sense of like, well, it is right. There is justification essentially means I had a sense of what is right. So to me, the relativization is only a morphing of what is absolute. We all know what's right and wrong deep down if we sincerely ask the question.
I'm wondering, is the child know that because you've told the child no? And so is it really knowing? Like, I think that a child often doesn't know, but then you've told. So now the child's informed.
So how does the child know that violating a no is wrong? Right?
They don't initially, but then you've conditioned them to know that by your voice. I mean, if you were to say no in a very happy, smiley way, as the same way you say, yes, please do more of that, they wouldn't know. And I think that, yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I'm not sure if that points to the idea of an absolute, because I think like, that's why a child will do all sorts of things, because they're trying to learn. And who are they learning from? The people around them.
That's true.
The other thing that I was thinking about is, Hari, you said this idea, you know, that Michael shared around the front page of the Wall Street Journal, that feels it's all external.
Right.
What if you use that external thought experiment? Like every, you know, people talk about what do you do when no one is looking versus what do you do when you think you're being watched? And so right. if everything that you were doing, you felt like was exposed to someone, then would that change your behavior first externally, but over time internally? And, you know, we can go into the spiritual aspect here, like in the absence of using the Wall Street Journal, like, there are many other ways that one can think about this. You can think about it as if a supreme power was able to see everything that I was doing, and I have to answer to that, then is that still external motivation? Where does it start to shift?
That's great. See, now what you've done is actually you've come to the intersection point between extrinsic and intrinsic, because you're using an extrinsic marker, but it's so deep, it's so intrinsic that actually they meet. So when you're thinking, well, if I knew that God was watching me, what would I do? Now you're going sort of to the deepest level. That it, like, there's nothing that builds our moral compass and our character better than that. So it's not so much about, you know, it shouldn't be that if somebody saw me, it's a question of if who saw me. Like, for example, in my life, when I think about if my guru saw me, and if he was watching what I was doing, and the understanding, I mean, this is very deep spiritual subject, but the understanding is that I should always feel that he's watching me, that he's always looking out for me, and he's my teacher, my caretaker. He's a father to me, and he's also a mystic. So I should always feel that he's watching me, and that shapes what I do and how I act when nobody's looking, like anything. So it's using an extrinsic motivator to actually jump up my intrinsic motivation. And at a certain point, there becomes no difference. And then that shapes my character.
So on this subject of character, I was in a meeting last week with someone who leads a 20, 25 person team at a large private equity shop here in London. And he was sharing a story with me that really struck me. He said that a lot of the junior people who join his team, the first thing they want to know is, what do I need to do to succeed? What do I need to do here to succeed? Like, what are the one or two things I need to focus on? And where he surprised me is he said, oh, I'm very clear about my answer to that question. I say, if you only focus on one thing, focus on building your character. And I wasn't expecting that answer from him. I really appreciated it. And I think that he shared also the people who joined the team are kind of baffled by that response and not sure what to do to actually build their character. Because okay, well, can you give me something more specific to work on? So how is this connected to, like, why would someone in that position talk about character, and how is that connected to the conversation that we're having around cutting corners? Because I don't think he was saying that so that his team doesn't end up on the front page of the Wall Street Journal. That was not the motivation behind that comment, but I think it is deeply linked to what we're talking about right now. And what is the cost of cutting corners at the same time?
Well, when we cut corners, we break trust. We break trust with ourselves, and we break trust with the people around us who do see what we're doing. And if they're not explicitly seeing that one specific action, it eventually seeps out in some way.
When you say we break trust with ourselves, what do you mean by that?
If we think of ourselves as a good person, which we all try to, all of us, even people who are more objectively not good people, but that doesn't exist. Even people who commit crimes and are punished for those crimes, there's some aspect of thinking of myself as justified or as a good person. And then when we violate that, that breaks that ability to see ourselves that way.
Okay. Yeah.
And that changes our identity, and then our actions start aligning more and more with that other identity. And so there are real consequences for breaking that self-trust. It also leads to less self-acceptance when we're not able to trust ourselves. And that can have all sorts of consequences when it comes to insecurities.
It's a little bit like this broken windows theory on the New York subway. Like if I'm... Which the idea that when all the window, there's graffiti on the trains and they're all, the windows are broken, like it just feels like it's the type of place where more crime, it's okay to commit crime, more crime gets committed. And so this idea of cleaning those subway cars every night, that changes the sort of environment. And I was thinking about what you said, Michael, just now. Am I the breaking of trust is, am I the type of person who does this? So when I keep doing that, I become defined to myself as the type of person who will cut these types of corners. And so that just becomes part of my self image. And that then has consequences.
Yeah. If you think about extramarital affairs, it's like, if I'm not somebody who does that, then I'm going to not do that. But as soon as I do that once, then I, in my mind, change the identity that I have. And my sense is that it becomes a lot easier to do a second and a third time after that, because now I'm that type of person rather than the type of person that I was before that.
Totally. Our actions shape our habits, right? We do one thing once, and it's a lot easier to make a habit out of it. We quote Emerson in our Bhagavad Gita course that you sow a thought, you reap an action. You sow an action, you reap a habit. You sow a habit, you reap a character. You sow a character, you reap a destiny. So that, and our identity shifts accordingly. That's really what happens. So it's a great point. And I would also just challenge about the objective nature. And we're talking about, well, is this all subjective? How do we know? Because all the sacred texts of the world give us objective statements about this. And at the end of the day, if you boil it all down, it's about selfishness. What's your motivation? How selfish are you being versus how much are you looking to really serve everybody? And when you see everyone is interconnected and everyone is as good as me on the level of substance, so that we're all human beings, we're all made of the same stuff. And at the end of the day, we're all souls, you know, we're actually, we have a spiritual essence. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna, the speaker, is very clear about what makes somebody objectively not good. It's when you act on these selfish motivations that only build up your own ego and only give you control and enjoyment. And at the cost of other people is the worst, right? So at the end of the day, even the worst person in this life is still a soul, and we respect the soul of everybody. But in this life, they're not acting as the soul, and they're not acting as good people. And that's a big problem. And I think that comes back to, like, what are we looking at here? What are the standards? What are the rules, the lines for cutting corners? It comes down to consciousness, motivation, and we can't afford to rationalize. No, this is really for everyone's benefit. We have to be deeply aware and deeply honest and fearlessly so.
I appreciate your bringing so much seriousness to this topic, and I would love to hear from each of you about some more innocent examples in your own life of cutting corners, where you can see what have you learned from it in terms of how it can become this unintentional cost to your character, to other people. Like, what Rasnath, you're smiling. I mean, you shared one example earlier. It seems like you have another one.
Well, I think my life is, I've done so much of this. Coming late to meetings is one way in which I see cutting corners.
Okay, like, how is it a corner cutting, first of all?
So when you're saying you're coming to a meeting on time, you're giving time to somebody.
Right.
It's a 1 hour meeting. You want to make the most of the time in two ways. One is whatever you need to talk about or discuss, but it also, somebody else is making a commitment to coming to that time.
Yeah.
Now, the way I have seen cutting corners is, it's okay to be 5 minutes. It's okay to be 5 minutes late, because I had something, I want to finish something else, or I had something more important to do.
Okay.
And it may have happened once or twice with legitimacy, where you didn't intend to, but something ran over. But it so easily becomes a way of being, where you tell somebody, "I'll be at this time," and you
give yourself a 5 minute buffer.
Yeah, you're always giving yourself a 5 minute buffer.
And what is the cost of that?
The first thing is, you know, respecting somebody's time, you know, which is the absolute basis. And it may seem like a small thing, but it's not a small thing. When somebody is just waiting for you, you know, when you're supposed to be there, and you don't feel, over time, you stop even feeling.
Become desensitized.
Desensitized, or you also, like, well, that's accepted, right? Going back to what we said earlier about, it just becomes the norm. And so I'm not even thinking about it. That's
accepted, becomes the expected.
Right. And you might even say, "I'm sorry," but you don't really mean it. You've done it so many times. And
and the sorry doesn't necessarily lead to correction. It just saves your face more than it actually leads to a change of behavior. The second thing is, when you send the message, what the message that you're sending perhaps is that, well, you're not worth my time. It's very subtle. And then you're also saying, well, it's okay to be late. So now you give rise to a culture, especially if you are in a position of influence and leadership. You are sending a message where you're saying, well, this is the norm. It's okay to be doing this.
And okay, so you're saying there's a consequence in terms of the impact on the other person. There's one in terms of an impact on culture.
Mm-hmm.
And then what is the impact on you?
Integrity, right? So when you make a commitment to come at a certain time, and when each time you compromise it, there is something about being out of integrity with yourself and your own commitments.
Yeah. And so and that can translate easily to other areas that might be more substantial. Not that this is not substantial, but potentially what you're saying is, all of a sudden, it's like what Michael was saying earlier. I'm the type of person that is a little flexible with my commitments. And that means not just in terms of showing up on time, but maybe in many other areas of my life.
Yes. And you know how they say when, and this is, I think they talk about ships, that when ships change, when they're sailing on the sea, if they get their direction wrong by half a degree or 1 degree, then where they end up at a certain time is way off than where they need to be going. So this may seem as a small gap, but the character compromise that it starts to create can be pretty significant.
That's great. I love the ship metaphor of just slight divergence from the direction, and where do you end up? So can you connect this example, and Hari, Michael, any of you, to character? Like, what? So I showed up 5 minutes late. That happened a few times. How can you connect this to, why is this a question of my character? Like, that feels very heavy all of a sudden.
because I'm not thoughtful about my values, and I'm not thoughtful about my impact on other people, and I'm not thoughtful about the, as Rasana mentioned, the level of respect that each person is worthy of. And you mentioned this, Vipin, you become desensitized. So I'm not actually aware of the cost, because I just become numb to it. I become shaped in a certain way where I don't even know what I'm missing, because this is just me now. And Michael, you mentioned this in terms of adultery. You start to become that kind of person. Your identity and your relationship with yourself shifts. And this is, again, an innocent example, which is what you asked for. But this is happening to us all the time in more substantial ways as well. And as you said, not that this is insubstantial, but there's a lot more substantial stuff that we afford ourselves the leeway to do.
Well, I would say, as we started talking about this example, there was a moment where I feel like all of you were talking to me. and then I was all of a sudden, this conversation has really like lit a fire under me. I know, Rasana, you were giving your own example, but
I am the biggest culprits
of this. And actually, I've never been more inspired to really look at what's happening there than in this moment, this conversation of like, what's the cost? Because I think I've generally assumed that the cost of that is pretty nominal, but this is a much bigger understanding of what
this is also to the first example that I gave about giving credit to where credit is due. It sort of still affects the character in a very similar way, where you do it once because you don't have the time, or you just wanted to make sure that what you needed to convey needed to go across.
And no one said anything.
And I got the clap.
I got the glow. Right? Yeah.
And then that just becomes a way of, it starts off innocently. And sure enough, there is a desire for credit. But it happens the first time where you are doing it for efficiency's sake. And then it just becomes a part of, like, that's how I roll, really. And so it's not too disconnected from character, really, cutting corners.
At the end of the day, the question we have to ask is this really about other people, or am I living a me-centered life where everything revolves around me and whatever works for me, like, that's what I'm going to do? Because that affects our service attitude, that affects our heart and soul, and our fulfillment, our depth, our connection with ourselves, with each other. It's efficiency is one motivation to cut corners, for sure. And that may even be like a more legitimate motivation in many ways. And then we have to ask, well, what is okay in the name of efficiency? And there's a lot that's not okay, and our culture is swept up in that. But there are even more difficult, more consequential motivations to cut corners, where it's really like, is it me-centered, or am I in the service of other people? And I cut corners because I let the world revolve around me, which is the ego life that covers the soul completely, the real self.
Wow, I didn't know where this conversation was going to go. And I'm so grateful to be having it. It has led to a much deeper conversation around character than I had envisioned. And I really appreciate that. I also feel like we need a full follow-up conversation about
character. I was thinking the same.
We need a conversation about character. And I want to end with one last question, which is, if I'm listening to this and I'm thinking, okay, we're talking about a lot of big stuff, and I can see what the potential consequences are. I think I'm doing things that are pretty innocent, but maybe I'll take a look. What's the first step that I could take that may help me see more clearly what I'm doing as I may be cutting corners and maybe understand some of the consequences. What's the first step for someone who's just listening to this?
I think there's two things that I would point people to, but I'm also really interested to hear about what you have to say, Hari and Razanath. The first is when there's a feeling of guilt internally, that's usually a pretty good signal that there's something that I'm violating about my personal integrity. Okay. And we all know what that feeling of guilt feels like. A lot of us push that away, sweep it under the rug, or feel like, or are actually always living with it. So I get comfortable with that sort of discomfort that I feel from the guilt. So my encouragement here would be to actually turn towards it and ask, like, what is this guilt trying to tell me? And to dig a little deeper there. The second thing, which is something that I had shared in my annual newsletter last year, was asking ourselves the question, what's really going on here? Like, what am I really trying to do here? And then assume that we're going to get a response from our ego the first time we ask ourselves that question. And so then ask ourselves one more time, no, what's really going on here? And hopefully that second answer, or maybe even a third time, will give us some clues as to where we might be cutting corners and straying away from the character that we really want to build.
Thank you, Michael. Hari or Razanath, anything you would add?
I so much appreciate that, Michael. I was just thinking, like, be really bold. Again, be fearless about this subject. It's so important. And see how this is not just like, oh yeah, this shows up here or there. Like, every industry is shaped by this mentality. It is so pervasive. And it's so naive to think that we're not being shaped by that because we're not on the top. I was thinking about the example of Anthony Hopkins, who said, when he got into acting, the first question he asked was, who do I need to sleep with to get to the top? What does that say? That's not like just the people at the top. That's how you function. That's the measure of success. That's how you get on. Is that about your acting? Is that about your talent and your craft? He's one of the most talented actors in all history. And this was the question that he was asking, right? So we better believe that this has sunk deep into the consciousness of all of us. And we have varying degrees of relationship to that and varying degrees of letting ourselves go there. And we should ask ourselves fearlessly, in the same vein as you mentioned, Michael, like, what, in what ways am I willing to go with the current? Where do I see the current in each field of work and in each sphere of personal life? Because it's there too. And in what way am I being affected by that current?
Wonderful. Thank you. Razanath, you get the last word.
I don't have anything more to add to what Michael and Hari Prasad have said. I agree that it takes honesty. It really takes honesty and sincerity. I think without those ingredients, It is really hard to change the course of our character.
Yeah.
And those are the real guardrails, honesty and sincerity, that really truly protect our character. When we compromise, and that's the challenge, when we compromise on those fundamentals, then everything over time can get compromised.
Well, to echo what Michael said earlier in this conversation, that we have good models. He particularly has good models now. And I think what he was referring to are the models right here. I have three models in this room that have changed how I think about character and have deeply affected my own character development. So I'm grateful to have the three of you as models in my life and as models for our community. And I'm so appreciative. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's really, you just named the spirit of our mission as we want to create examples, because that's the most powerful thing. What really influences us in the right direction, in the direction of being our best self, is having the examples and the influence of the people that are taking that to heart. So thank you so much. And it's mutual.
I actually need to say one more thing, because Rajanath, your example in the beginning speaks to the example that I have now with all of you. You shared earlier about cutting corners by not citing your sources when giving a presentation. And we have a culture of accountability here, which has come from when you guys started and developed Upbuild. And that's such a core part of our culture. I just wanted to share that now when I'm doing that, because I grappled with that my whole life. I suffered from doing the same thing my whole life. And now there's an excitement actually about citing my sources and giving credit where credit is due. And that is because of the models.
Oh, beautiful.
It's taken some very painful learning, I can say, for myself. I'm very deeply grateful to Hari Prasad for not compromising. And when it could have easily, it could have easily gone that route. And I always say that he is the moral compass of Upbuild. So I appreciate the acknowledgement, and I can also say that he does carry the burden.
You guys are all carrying me. It's so funny.
more than I've seen anybody else carry it. So.
I've also had the same experience as Michael around this, and the model that has been created at Upbuild. And so, well, enough of this love fest. Now we will thank you all for being here and for having this conversation. And I can't wait to do this again with all three of you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay. Thanks to everyone for listening.